Namaste. Welcome back to Come As You Are podcast. I'm Rome from Studio Rome. In this episode, we have a very special guest for you. You're going to love this guy. He's an engineer. He's a master marksman. He's a Tai Chi practitioner. He's a motorcycle enthusiast. He's an inventor. He's written multiple books. But the reason that he's here, the real reason that he's here, is because he's the first international bioenergy healer. And today, he's going to show us all about what his techniques are. In fact, he's even going to teach us some. But right now, let's check out some of his work.
You have a nucleus in the middle, which is positively charged.
Right there.
And you have electrons traveling around. Once you think you have it, press your palm.
Cover the entire head, and I'm going in one direction only. Smoky, watery, misty, foggy. Sounds better than aggravating. But that's what we're doing. Intensifies and eventually results in. There are some pathways that we can't really see.
Well, I am very happy to have you here, man. I've been doing some rapid research into your bioenergy, this the latest and the most upgraded energy healing. Man, I'm jacked, and it's so great to have you here. Thank you so much for being here.
Excellent. Thank you for having me.
So, what are you doing today? What's your normal day? Your normal day routine then?
It has changed since the pandemic. And quite frankly, it worked out for me really well. I do a lot of long distance healing as part of my job. So I got to stay home even more than I did before. I didn't travel much or do house calls or any of that. So meditation is the start of my day.
Mm, same.
First the coffee. I'm bad.
You're a coffee guy?
I gotta have a little coffee in the morning. Kind of counterproductive, right? It sounds like it. Mm. And then after that, I meditate. I worked on 7 people this morning, and then I write a report to them, my findings and what changed, what didn't in their energy. And then we go from there. And just about every day starts like that for me.
Wow. And so your normal routine is wake up, smile, do a little meditation, and you're right to work.
Yes, pretty much. Well, I get up a little bit earlier than the meditation starts. So there's a little bit of stretching, like a little bit of morning routine to keep me sane and healthy as well. Hmm. My big yellow lab is not with me anymore. He made it to 15, but for 15 years, that was part of the routine. And when he was younger, then we ran for 3 miles every morning that was the minimum to keep him at bay. And that's when I was in best shape of my life, probably. I think every day should contain a certain things. Number one thing is to take care of yourself.
Definitely.
If you don't do that, you can't take care of anybody else. You can't really enjoy life fully. So that's number one. Number two, do something that maintains your living, but make it something happy, right?
Positive.
Yes. Yeah. Spend some time with loved ones, even if on the phone. But there are certain, you know, things that have to be there every day. It's been part of my philosophy for many years. And I believe that you need that time for yourself, no matter what you do. Every day, it has to be a me time, a little meditation or a workout or whatever makes you feel happy. And then you have time and energy for everybody else.
It's funny that you mentioned that. I just put that in my blog about having a sacred space for yourself. You know, give yourself a little bit of time every day, even if it's to reset and rejuvenate, you know, and then move forward. I believe
the older generation knows how time has sped up. Whether it's a real physical phenomenon or just in our minds,
right.
But every day is shorter, things go by faster. So look at life right now, short commercials, short videos, TikTok, everything is fast. Right? Nobody stays with one thing for a long time. Attention span is shorter. So we do have to slow it down. I don't say that's good either, to be slow all the time. You know, there has to be some kind of a balance.
Right. Yeah, definitely balance is key. I think the biggest thing that I work with people about meditation and getting into their spiritual awakening is to take that time and slow down and be more mindful of, you know, the things that are in front of you. So, like you're saying, so many people are such a fast pace, man. They got their heads and compartmentalized and so many different things. I mean,
especially for them, it's very important to calm down and have that me time, mm-hmm. or balance it with something else, you know, some kind of an activity that will counter whatever they are doing.
So you,
I go on a motorcycle and ride it fast, that's my balance.
You're a motorcycle enthusiast. Let's talk about that. I saw a video of you doing a dragon. How long ago was that?
Oh, I go every year to the
Dragon.
Do you
really? Yeah, yes, we did it. Yes. We did it in 2009. But that was a long time ago. Yeah, you got a BMW then. Is that all you ride?
I have. Well, the last few times I went on a BMW, but I have a Yamaha, an FZ1. If I feel like going really fast, and I have some old timers, old Airhead BMWs that I rebuilt.
So are you in a group or a club that meet up there every year, or you just do it by your...
No, but I have a close group of friends. We're enthusiasts. We like the curves. We into that kind of riding, not much of cruising. But every year is something. Last year, we did a trip in the Alps, the Dolomites, all over the Italian, Austrian, Swiss passes. It's amazing. Very few people know I am part of another business. I'm actually a CEO of the cognardphoto.com. Curve photo would be the American version, taking photographs in the curves, similar to the Dragon.
Yeah.
There are photographers there. This is in Europe. It's a European operation.
So you take it from the perspective of the rider then?
Or do you you're in the curve. Our photographer, we have two of them now on the Stelvio Pass in Italy. It's only open 3 months a year. It's always snowed in. It's the most exciting road on the planet.
Really?
And they're sitting in the curve, and as the bikes go by, they just boom, 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 take a bunch of pictures. Very, very specific artistic pictures with a little bit of a slower exposure. So you have a little bit of washed away the background,
but
you see the bike clearly. It's from below, so the bike is bigger than the, you know, the helmet. And so people buy that. It's very interesting. We connected our passion for motorcycles and photography and being together. Our goal really is to make these trips every year as a part of the business itself.
Now, you're a rider and enthusiast. Do you build bikes as well?
Yes. Mainly old cafe racers.
Is that just a hobby, or is that also?
It's a hobby. But I've been building them since I was 14 or so. Mm. And I finished engineering in college, probably for that reason. But I never worked a day in engineering. I was about halfway through college when my other gifts came out.
Well, you went to college. Where did you go to college?
In Yugoslavia, former Yugoslavia.
And when mm-hmm. you came in the States, 91?
Yes. Yes, I was here on vacation when the war started in Yugoslavia.
Oh, shit.
And so it was about time to go back home, and everybody said, no, stay there. And
it reminds me of that movie, Tom Hanks, Terminal.
Yes. It was nearly like that, but I was able to stay and kind of figured I'll stay till things cool down. But by the time that happened.
So talk about that. What was that like? Being out of your own country, watching this whole thing unravel.
You know, it's tough watching now what happens in Ukraine. But in Ukraine, you know, you have a clear enemy who's coming, attacking your turf, mm-hmm. your mm-hmm. country. But there we had the country itself, you know, the one republic against the other. Mm. So it was a civil war, basically.
Legitimate civil war, yeah.
Yes. And they were, you know, the recruiting doesn't go with a letter anymore. They come and pick you up. So everybody who served military, which was everybody, it was mandatory, was called in. But the problem is that the military was such that we were mixed up somewhere else in the country, you know, from everywhere.
Right,
so he had friends from all over the country. And I could not fathom the idea that I would be here and shooting at maybe my friend on the other side. So it was pretty screwed up. You know, you didn't know where to stand or how. And they come up with the reasons why it happened. And, you know, it's stupid. It's all stupid.
There was a big buildup to it, though. And how long did it let the revolution, I guess, the outbreak, how long did it last?
And I mean, it went from one place to the next, you know, it was first, I don't know, just a couple of days in Slovenia, nothing crazy. But then Croatia was a little bit longer. And then Bosnia was full blown crazy. And it just went on for 2000 or so. So at least 9 years.
Wow.
Maybe 10.
So during that time, I mean, you're in the States. Did you, I mean, it was kind of a buildup. It was kind of a shock to you that it all just broke out while you were away.
Yes, absolutely. I mean,
did you want to get back? Did you?
I did, but you know, for what purpose? Hmm. Even my mom was telling me like, no, I'd rather have you somewhere else than here. Even if I don't see you, you know, better there alive than here, God knows.
Yeah.
So it's tough, you know, and then you're a young person and, you know, life is open and we thought we lived in an awesome country up to that point. You know, it wasn't part of the Eastern Bloc. We had free passports to go anywhere, free enterprise. The country itself was beautiful.
Yeah, it was growing. It was industrious and yeah.
But it happens and it breaks my heart seeing how many people have to leave Ukraine now and you know, it's not
you
a
have
few families.
You have an emotional understanding of what's going on there. So,
well, it's a terrible thing. You know, I mean, we had hurricane here in Florida. Charlie went through here. You know, we had no power, no water, nothing for a week in the middle of August in Florida. You know, hot and crazy. But after a week, the power came back. You know, I washed my laundry, whatever, ate something warm, and that was it. And help kept coming in. But now imagine a hurricane every day, you know, you don't know where the bomb will hit or so. We don't think of the simple things as just drinking water or food or such. Mental health, you know, forget that. So it's really tough. It will take many years or generations to get back to normal.
Yeah.
And it's hard to imagine. We're in the 21st century and things like this are happening. You know, we have the intelligence at this age to fix anything. I mean, I know with motorcycles, there's something I can't fix. I go and Google it, right? And there will be a video of somebody fixing that thing. You have the power of gods under your fingers now. Any information is available. we know that you know, certain things are bad for us,
right?
You know, yet we see the same things on commercials every night, and it's tough to comprehend. If you came from another planet, you know, what's the deal here? You know, what goes for what? Oh, the corporations made this price so high. Who runs the corporations? Aren't right. there humans? You know, it's hard that everything is run by profit, not by humanity or love or love for nature. I mean, we know we're, you know, cutting out trees. Well, let's try an alternative. Or everybody should plant a tree every year, or something simple. I mean, it's not a big deal.
Yeah, you know, we've all seen that meme. If there was one thing you could take out of the world, what would it be? And my answer has always been greed. Because you take greed out of the equation, there's so many things, so many problems that just dissipate. They would just go mm-hmm. away. You know, hunger, homelessness, illness, healthcare, you know, all of that. It's mm-hmm. just because when you're thinking about someone else besides yourself, you're being in service to humanity. We were just talking about this the other day, the whole thing that was going on over in Ukraine, and someone had asked, you know, how did it build up? How did it develop to be this way? And there was, you know, the general answers around the table. And it came to me, and my answer was just balance. There has to be balance. And the group that where I was with, you know, we're enlightened, and some of us are awakened, and they know that, you know, the shift has been on.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's interesting. It's always the blaming, you know. Well, he hit me back first, you know, or so. It's always some different power that we can think of that runs the whole show. Or they go back, well, in history, you know, this was ours. Well, how far back do you go in history? If you go back to, I don't know, 1260 or so, when the Mongolians overran Russia, then that should be Mongolian, you know.
Yeah.
Moscow was a village at the time. Kiev was the capital of Russia at the time.
You like history, do you?
Yes, and I'm lucky enough to have a few historians as my clients.
Oh yeah.
One of them wrote several books on Genghis Khan, Batu Khan, Kublai, you know, that whole history, and I got to hear it during treatments. And it's very interesting, you know. I mean, all of Europe would be Mongolia if the Khan didn't die at the time. They were right that they were actually fighting already King Bela of Hungary. They were about to just overtake, you know, like Pope, who cares? You know, they were fast. They were amazing power at the time. But the Khan died, and they had to go back to choose another one, which at the time took like 4 years or so. Pre-internet,
yeah. In the process, yeah, right. Cover all that land by
a little bit different voting system and such, but for a history buff, it would be an interesting situation. But again, 21st century, and we're shooting people. It makes no sense.
How do you think the historians will look at us 1500 years from now?
Like barbarians, pretty much.
Right. Behind the times, right?
If you look at history, I mean, up till the little house on the prairie, everything was really organic and natural, right? And then the industrial age started, and in 100 years, we went, you know, to the moon. So it's exponential growth, but we have to count little things. How many of us live on this planet? What do we want to eat? And such things, yeah, and interhuman relations,
you know. I wonder if the past civilizations that been wiped out, the other four civilizations that have been wiped out previous to us, if they came to a heightened industrial age, technology age, and then it went, you know, I wonder if it's a repeating pattern or a rhyming pattern.
Well, history repeats itself. That's why we have to look back and study it and learn from it.
This is true.
But the fact is, we are all connected on this planet. There's no such thing that you screw up one part of it and the others won't feel it sooner or later. We're energetically connected.
Absolutely.
You know, an idea comes up somehow in the universe, somebody will work on it. Somebody will pick it up. Individually, it's like a network of people, of these little energies around. You think of someone and the phone rings and that person is on the other line, right? How many times does it happen to us? Or text messaging or so. I have so many people that I think of.
Been together for a long time and one would be thinking something and the other one would say it out loud.
Right. Same thing. Yeah. So we could communicate telepathically at one point if we take that direction. Less talk, more thinking, you know.
Yeah, well, we're given something else to divert ourselves.
Right. It makes it much easier.
You know, yeah. I think it's just convenience. You know, it's like it's like we were talking, you know, the food that we're being sold, the food that we digest, most people digest, is just mostly out of convenience. You know, it's not easy to raise animals and raise vegetables and stock up for the winter if you live in a winter state, that kind of thing. And it would be virtually impossible for the population these days to do it on their own. But the things that we allow ourselves to ingest, both mentally and physically, like water and food and, you know, our surroundings, I tell people sometimes I call it a meat suit. You are a meat suit. That's all. It's just a spacesuit of meat and you're allowed to live there. And the better you treat your suit, the better optimum you'll have for life, you know? And then
right.
If you want to go with convenient, which most of us do, and I admit I do sometimes too, I cheat, but you know, it's going to have repercussions, you know? So.
Yes. Sooner or later. So sad thing for the next generation, but you have to see where you started and build on that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we can't cry over spilled milk and what they have done to us before, because it looked smart at the time. Hey, we have forests everywhere. Let's cut them out. You know, build something. But now that is past. We have to look past that. Same goes with the fuel. You know, there's the sun, there's the wind. We have all kinds of even nuclear options that could be safe. But we still keep burning the same fuel.
Yeah.
And it's not really the cars. I mean, there's a lot of cars, but how many tankers, big ships that burn a lot more fuel than all cars together, airplanes. And so there's a lot more, even if we take care of the cars.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, get a bicycle.
Right. Ride more. It's healthy for you.
Yeah, yes.
For sure. Yeah. Well, you know, it's interesting that the process that one goes through when they go through an awakening, what their modalities change, what they start educating themselves on things and they go through a process of developing new habits, mm-hmm. right? And, you know, habits become routine. And then it's just like you and I or anybody else, we have a routine in the morning. You know, you wake up, you have your coffee, and you've been doing that for years. And if you wanted to change something to do something different, you'd have to be mindful of that routine. So you have to get that routine in there. And I think a lot of it is for people, it's hard to change that routine. It's hard to change those.
Well, we are all, as species, we're easy to get addicted to something. And it's not all bad addictions, you know. We're addicted to sugar, but other people are addicted to running. They get that rush from running. Some people are addicted to the gym. Some people are addicted to alcohol. You know, there's always some addiction in us. So we just have to kind of form a healthier addiction. I don't know if that makes sense.
No,
you know,
absolutely.
If the evening news bothers you, watch a comedy show or something else, or read a book. There's a solution for everything nowadays. You just have to be aware of what really bothers your system.
Yeah, I think there's coming to, you can see it in our culture, there's more of a shift to being more mindful of diet, you know, what the diet is. I mean, I've noticed it we've been eating organic foods for years, but I've noticed it because now I don't have to go to a market to get organic food. I get a selection in a grocery store.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And recently the selection is becoming larger, even in a canned processed foods, you know.
Yes, it's easier to live healthy now. Know?
So that shows me, as we all know, we vote with our dollars and they pay attention. The businesses pay attention. So they're going to give us selections that we're willing, you know, to keep us in the store. So that shows me that there has been that shift to be more mindful of, you know, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. food and process. Now I think, and with, you know, biotherapy, I think there's another shift coming, and you have to talk about this because it's really popular now. I mean, it's coming on very strong. You've been doing this for decades and watching it just slowly migrate. Now it's just,
yes.
Right. So
yes,
tell me since this new popular, you know, belief about all this, there seems to be a lot more faith in it now.
Well, we're slowly awakening to things that, that surround us that we don't really see. We know about frequencies more. We know about energies more. Mm-hmm. You know, I have to teach people about the energy itself, how everything is energy. Just like I would have to teach a fish how everything is water around them.
Do you find in your seminars that you don't have to teach the basics as much as you used to?
More people are open to it now, definitely. Okay. So the concept of energy is definitely out there. When I started 30 some years ago, well, that was in Yugoslavia. I would stop somebody's headache and the next day the whole street would know about it. You know, people talk there, they talk to neighbors, they communicate more. And it was interesting. Or I would move somebody without touching them, you know,
the story, word spread. No, the story you got to tell is the one about you and your boys making drinks, making change in the bars. It's like you were doing this telekinesis with people, right? Moving energies.
But what happened, I mean, I knew of my, you know, I felt this energy my whole life. I couldn't identify it. And a family friend, my dad's good friend, was dabbling with this energy healing. And he showed me how to feel the energy and how to use a pendulum and little things. And it opened a whole new world. You know, just the door opened and all of a sudden on the other side, everything is different. And at that time, there was no literature about this. I could not find anything on the energy itself.
Sure.
Far Eastern philosophy, stuff like that.
Poorly translated.
And then at the beginning, it was all experiments. You know, I would stop somebody's headache and my hand would hurt or something. You know, I didn't know how to use the energy. I kind of slowly learned as an instinct. And one day my mom's back was hurting. And the same thing, I kind of felt the energy by then, but I could not fully visualize of what I was doing.
Was your mom aware of your...
Well, yes, we kind of... Well, eventually when I figured it out, she felt the energy coming from my hands, and there's a specific way how to make it happen like that. I'll explain it.
Okay.
So I was standing behind her, and I tried to pull this pain out of her. That was my idea at the time. In reality, you want to pull the excess energy, which causes the pain. And once you get rid of it, the pain is gone. Now, at that time, again, it was just an experiment. So I pulled this energy out, and suddenly my mom starts leaning back. I'm like, what the heck? I pushed the energy forward. My mom goes forward.
Wait, how
pull
old
it
were
back.
You?
My mom
how,
goes
how old were you when this was going on?
I was already like in my 20s, like oh, early 20s.
Okay.
And so like, mom, what are you doing? She's nothing. What are you doing? I don't know. What are you doing? You know, back and forth. And I realized that I could feel that energy and I could catch it and push her and pull her with it. So the same night I went out, and this was a normal thing, college years. We were out every night at the pub with my buddies, and
sure.
And I told them what happened. And they're like, yeah, right. You know, BS. Let me see. So I tried on one of them, and he got a little movement. Let's try the next one. By the end of the night, we were making bets in beer, who's going to move, who's not.
So literally, you were getting just like direct confirmation.
Yes, but I, you know,
right away from that.
It was a cool thing, but scary at the same time. I didn't know the potential. I didn't know what to do with it. I had another friend. He was my first real healing experiment. He was a long distance runner, like ultra marathon runner, and his ankle was hurting. And like, let me see if I can do something with it. And that was the first time somebody confirmed, like, ooh, I feel something. And like, ooh, I feel something too.
But what do you mean?
Again, no idea.
They're confirming. They can feel your energy.
Yes, yes. Okay. So that was my first confirmation of that. And then I stopped his pain, and he never had it again. He had other issues, I'm sure, but that was done.
Long distance runners, they're always hurting.
And then, like 2 weeks after the mom incident, he ran over with the newspaper. Get it? with an article about a professor in Belgrade who was measuring the energy fields. And I got to get in, and we went through this whole experimental stuff, and he pulled me over and said, hey, you were born to do this. And of course I was halfway through college by then, and I had to figure out what to do. But I ended up finishing college just so
get the engineering degree
out of my thing, but I knew
mom
then
was happy. Everyone's
yes, yes. But I knew right then that this was going to be my profession.
That's awesome.
And it started. I started right away with some family neighbors. The first month, I had maybe 30 patients altogether. 2 months later, I had 30 patients a day. I ended up studying with. At that time, and still, he's probably the foremost healer in the world, Zdenko Domancic. He's from Croatia. Supposedly, by now, he has healed over 1.5 million people. That's a
huge number.
How
many people has he taught?
I have no idea.
That's
he started the serious teaching later. I know there were only a few of us at the time. But he still does it, and his son continued, and his students, he still does it in Slovenia. So it's quite amazing.
I had written his name down. Can you spell it for us so we, because I had to look around and find it.
Yeah, nobody can pronounce
it. It's a very hard pronunciation, but it's even worse spelling.
It's Zdenko, Zdenko. That's his first name, and the last name is Domancic, with the little things on them, Domancic.
Yeah, and he's mastered. He's the master. So this is getting great.
He's the one who like spearheaded the whole movement in Yugoslavia at the time. He was the first one who proved the existence of the energy, and
well, he was probably the challenge. First one out of the Asian culture that did it.
Yes, yes. Of course, the Asians have been doing that.
Yeah,
I mean, Qigong has been around forever.
To Europe, even Eastern Europe.
Yes, yes.
Huge.
However, the method itself, you know, the what?
Where did he study from?
Various places, various people. But he was already born with it. And as a kid, they would take him to the neighbors to work on them and so on. So quite interesting. Different route.
A young prodigy then.
Yes. And I figured, you know, in my mind, after about 100,000 people, you kind of figure out what works and what doesn't. So he systematized the method, what to do for what illnesses, how many minutes you have to hold a certain spot. So it's, even if you're not talented, you know, you learn the minutes, if nothing else. What I changed in this teaching is I like to teach people how to feel the energy and how to see the energy, to be fully aware of it. So they can also find the areas that are out of balance, that are beyond the patient's objectivity, you know, what they feel themselves. You know, you can have an elbow pain, but the problem is in your neck or so.
Right.
So once you learn that, and you learn how to, which way to pull the energy out or push it in, learn the patterns and how to jumpstart the energy flow to prevent the formation of these blockages, that's the system itself. So we find the imbalances in the energy field, we take the excess off, add where it's needed, and once everything is balanced, we still jumpstart that energy flow, kind of starting a river, you know, clearing the dam. And the body is able to continue its natural function, which includes healing itself. So technically, I don't really heal you. I just fix your energy. Mm. And the body is able to do the rest. More like energy engineering here.
The energy engineer. I was going to say, yes. you brought in both worlds to the same thing with your technical background and your massage background also. You could pinpoint all that. Well, this is a great time to segue into this video. Why don't you go ahead and set up this video? We're going to watch this video, guys, and you're going to be amazed. But go ahead, set this video up for us. And
another positive from the pandemic, because I have been working on this video since my last book came out in 2016 on the bioenergy healing, and then various things came in between. One was the pandemic. However, my cousin was visiting from Budapest at the time, and he's a filmmaker, post-production expert. So we did the whole thing during the pandemic and the production. So it's a super happy, perfect result after such a long time. But what I did, I put together my live seminars into 7 videos. So you learn every detail, just like in the seminar, you learn how to feel the energy, how to see it, how to move it, manipulate it, even long distance healing and such. But you learn it with special effects, unlike the live seminars. Here we put in things how to see the energy easier. So we imagine it for you, just like any movie would, right?
Mm-hmm, right.
But it's so much easier to learn this way. And my first 2 videos are actually for free, so anybody can look at them, see if this is something for them, and then they can pay for the rest, which is, again, quite inexpensive compared to live seminars, which I still do, but less, again, because of the whole pandemic.
There's nothing better than being in presence of a healer. I understand there's remote, but
yes.
I could tell you from personal experience, receiving and giving. Being in presence, sort of thing. But let's check this video out and then we'll come right back.
Okay. Now, the human body is very peculiar. This energy is all the way around us, forming an egg shape, probably as far as you can reach. Now this changes again all the time, it pulses. When you have a good day, your energy is wider. When you have a bad day, your energy is a little bit weaker. So this is what we're trying to influence. Everything in the universe is supposed to be in a certain balance. All the planets keep following their suns. There's always a certain distance between everything. But everything is also in a constant movement. Nothing ever stops. Thus, your energy never stops either. It's in a constant movement. So when we have a nice, strong energy around us, we have a strong immune system. We're protected. When the energy gets weak, that's when problems will happen. Not necessarily. However, bigger problems happen when there are individual areas around the body where you have too much energy or too little energy. Why does that happen? Many reasons, tons of reasons. Also, we have to remember that this energy moves. It goes up in the front and goes down in the back. Think of the Earth's magnetic field, almost like half of it, constant movement. Now, when this stops moving or gets stuck, too much energy can accumulate in one area, too little gets to the other area, and problems happen. So, how does the brain really influence this energy? Let's go back to what this energy looks like. Again, think of an egg shape around you, just as far as you can reach. This would be a healthy aura, still fluctuating but healthy.
Even if the whole energy gets a little bit weaker, it's no big deal. If it gets bigger, of course it's better for you. But in this flow, in this constant flow, up in the front, down in the back, a little obstacle can happen for some reason. I'll give you a quick example. Modern times, everybody has a cell phone, right? You look down at your cell phone, already your head is not straight up. You're fighting gravity. Eventually, the neck muscles will start getting tighter and tighter and will reduce space and will become dense where the energy can't flow through properly. So back here, the energy will stop and it will start accumulating around your head. Boom, excess energy always accompanies pain. Well, always, 95% of the time, it's a better comparison. So not enough energy goes down through the spine, too much accumulates around the head. So it's not only one problem, it may create many other different problems. Now, what do you do when you have a headache? You pop a few pills, right? And you wait for it to numb and the headache is gone. You haven't really fixed the problem. You don't know why you got the headache. You just numb it, ignore it, and move on, right? What would be your other option? Well, you could call me. It would take me about 2 minutes to take that excess energy off, shake it off, get rid of it, and the headache is gone just like that. It literally takes 2 minutes. Now, if you're not a gifted healer, you've never done this, you can still learn how to do it within 5 minutes.
Well, that if you had any misbelief or doubt, that would have to put it right into you just to see that happening, because those are real time events. I mean, so
yes, yes.
What is your? I'm sure you've had people in the past that had felt that it was just all, you know, hogwash and wishy washy, and you know, didn't believe in it, but then had experienced it, and then had a change of faith.
That yes, has to usually
be probably the best experience, right? To actually have that confirmation that it is true happening right there.
Yes, especially at the beginning, it was very important to get it. And later on, it was just annoying to try to explain it to each person again and again and again. But now people are a lot more open to energy.
Yeah, like we said before, it's the terminologies are out there. The conversations are a little bit more easy to break into now.
I like, you know, because of the engineering background, I like to explain the energy from a quantum physical point of view, not something woo-woo, you know, but actual physical thing. And it's very easy to comprehend. And when people realize that, then again, all these doors open, you know, you see beyond what you see now. You know, you don't see the air right now, but you know you can't live without it, right? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. There are so many chemical elements in it that are invisible to us. This is a whole array of energy around. Well, right now, thousands of radio waves go through you, right? You just don't pick them up. You don't have that dial. Same way, thousands, millions of people are connected through these electromagnetic waves. We just have to tune in when we want to connect with somebody. Mm. So that accidental thinking of somebody that you think was an accident and the phone rings, you can actually learn to do that consciously. You just like meditation. Anybody can learn anything. You know, you just have certain gifts. Like I will never slam dunk, but basketball.
You said a quote, one of your videos, man, it really resonated with me because I think it was the hammer on the nail. You said, there's a Lance Armstrong, but not everybody's Lance Armstrong, but right. Most people know how to ride a bike.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
So with that just makes all kinds of sense to me, because there are people who have natural ability that mm-hmm. ride bikes better, to have a bigger lung capacity, stronger burning. They have more focus. There are people that have to practice that. The people have to work really mm-hmm. hard and never will get to that level. But what it is everyone can learn how to ride a bike, and it's really on you how much effort you want to put into it, how skill.
Exactly.
Lance Armstrong didn't become Lance Armstrong, the incredible bike rider, by eating McDonald's and sitting on his ass and not touching his toes in the showers, not taking any time for himself,
right?
You know, and not working on these skill sets. Mm-hmm. He devoted everything to becoming the best bicyclist that there was. Now, you know, I didn't know about bicycles. There was a team. Well. There was a team, but
it was a good example at the time.
Analogy, right. Your body is that you have the ability to make your transistor
right
finely tuned. You just have to implement all those efforts and put into it.
We were all born with a certain gift. If you found it, perfect. If you found your gift, that's the best thing that can happen to you in your life. But nevertheless, even without a gift, you can do anything. I, you know, famously stop headaches within a couple minutes without touching you.
Everybody can has teach headaches. So that was, it was key for me. I ran right over to my wife. I'm like, come here, let me show her.
Yes, and you can learn to do the same. It may take you a little bit longer, maybe even 5 minutes or six, but you can do it, and it's still faster and more natural than any painkiller. If anybody can do it, it's so easy. Or feeling the energy, seeing the energy. Once you open your eyes to it, it's a different world.
Now,
you appear to be solid, right? You know, we feel that the solidness of the body, but deep inside, 70% is water. And so you look inside that water, what's happening there? We know now that water has memory. It has energy, picks up the energy easier. But if you go inside, it's made of molecules, hydrogen and oxygen molecules, which are gases. You go deep inside those, you'll find atoms. Mm-hmm. And now is where you have to open your eyes, because that nucleus, if you magnify it to the size of a pinhead, the closest electron would be, you know, a quarter mile away. And this empty space is just empty space. It's this energy holding us together. And then one atom, then the next, then the next, then the next. I mean, if you could see that atom in real life, if you could magnify it like that, you would see a giant ball, right? A half a mile size giant ball. But in reality, you only see that electron going around so fast that it looks like a giant ball, like when you spin a pendulum. However, there's really no matter in it. It's just that energy, maybe tiny little bit something that we think is energy or actual dense matter. But you put all these nothings together and end up with this. But 99.9999999% of this is empty space. Mm-hmm. The entire humankind could fit in a marble if you make that empty space disappear. It's very interesting, you know, and when you look at the energetic body, how the energy travels, it's actually very simple.
Like a torus, right?
Like an yes, in a way. And you know, you think of the energy on the outside, it's like going up in the front and going down in the back. You want to make like this constant flow, and it goes up in the front, down into the ground in the back. And this constant flow makes you go. Little bit of glitch and you feel it. You may not even have to, you know, do something physically to feel that energy change. You can have a thought, a negative thought, boom, your energy gets small. Positive thinking, you know, happy friends, family, you open up, your energy opens up just like that.
Yeah, you are the energy that you create.
Yes, yes. And whatever you think is exactly what's going to happen energetically with you.
And that's where, you know, we talk about that energy that we create. So many people live in fear or past traumas in their lives, and they re-feel that energy over and over again. So that's
yes,
and try re-changing that energy to create something, a different shift.
My teacher told me many years ago that all illness are based in stress. And at that time, some 15 years ago or so, I was thinking, well, I don't know. I mean, McDonald's and, you know, there are other things that will cause illness. But in essence, it's the stress that's on the body, on your system, However, since then, I did discover that, yes, stress is the biggest problem, biggest issue you can have.
Is it that stress is an energy blocker? If it blocks
it's
the flow
it's an energy weakener, blocker, slower. Mm-hmm. It depends how it happens. Just for a quick moment of stress, your energy, even for that split second, it gets weak and then goes back. Now, if you hold on to that stress, you hold on to that weak energy. And the weaker your energy, the more vulnerable you are to everything else. During the height of the pandemic, when everybody had to stay home, the masks, the everything, the craziness, I discovered so many people with stress. And it looked so much worse than the average problems. And I still see that. You know, it's almost a different sort of energy. And you think it, you're you're detrimental to your own health that way.
Yeah.
So stress has never served anybody unless, you know, a lion is chasing you right now. You need the stress and the adrenaline, fight or flight. Mm-hmm. But you don't need it otherwise. So you have to de-stress your system all the time. That's the biggest challenge today.
To find that balance. You can get just little stressors all day long.
Little ones, of course, they will always be there. You drive a car, you're in constant
stress. You watch
stress,
a movie, depending on the topic of the movie.
Yes,
crazy.
Yes.
News.
The problem is when you hold on to that stress. You know, somebody cuts you off on the road, you can go, and be like that all day. Or you can go, and you know that it was nothing personal, right? Mm. They just... whatever, they didn't know how to drive, they didn't see you, whatever it is, get it over with, let it go. I may say a few curse words in Hungarian, nobody understands it, I get it out and it's forgotten. You know, I won't let that mess up my day. But that's a simple thing. It can go to any heights. You know, anything can get you stressed. It's your choice whether you hold on to it or not. So positive thinking is extremely important. My actual philosophy that has carried me for like 30 years, everything happens for a reason. You can look for divine reason or logical reason or so, it doesn't matter. You know, there's a reason for everything. Number two, everything in the universe has two parts, right? So there's something positive in everything that happens. And number three, well, don't piss against the wind. Go with the flow.
Is that an old Yugoslavian term too?
It's my thing. Yes, it's a Yugoslavian term.
I want to say that in Yugoslavian.
Actually, in Hungarian, ne pišil sail alan.
Say it again.
Ne pišil sail alan.
I remember that. That's great. That's a classic, folks. Write that one down.
Or Serbian, ne pišaj prema vetru.
I like that. Good stuff.
But in essence, you know, the bottom line is positive thinking. Yeah. You see, now when you learn to think positive, at the beginning, I always tried to look for it until I saw it. Then I realized that it was there, whether I looked for it or not. So no matter what event happened, that was, you know, negative in appearance, I knew that there's something positive attached to it. And right away, it's not a negative event anymore. It's just a moment in time that, you know, you may have left your guard down or so. And build it back up, boom, boom, positive. If you have problems with that, too many other problems, how can I think positive if I have this or that? Write a list of the things that are positive. Mm. You know, it's sunny, beautiful day. Or if it rains, it's great for the grass, something, you know, but there's always something positive. Mm. And you keep adding to that list and you realize that you know, essentially life is good.
Yeah, gratitude,
whatever we are here to do.
Having gratitude in your life is immensely powerful.
Yes.
I start my day before I even open my eyes. Giving gratitude, and I finish my day the same way.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a good place to be, even in the worst of days. And I find myself to have less and less bad days, you know? Just,
yeah, it's a good habit, you know? Yeah. It takes over your mind slowly.
Yeah, true. So, that. It will change your energy. It will change your frequency. And I guess, I guess a term people would know would be aura, right? It would change their aura. This was the color of their aura, the strength of their aura, the diameter of their aura.
And there are so many devices nowadays that show you the picture of it, that measure the energy. It's really not such a off thing anymore. You know, it's there. And anybody can learn to do it. And anybody can learn. Let's try right now.
Sure.
To feel the energy. How about that?
All right.
That's one of those abstract things like, well, I felt you, but I don't know how or so. So let's learn the proper way of feeling your energy. So put your arms up straight like this and relax them.
Okay.
I want you to feel the difference between relaxed and straight up like this. There's a little bit of tension in your fingers, right? Okay. Straight like this. Now with this tension, hold an imaginary basketball. So you went from relaxed to a little bit tense. Okay, you have to have a little bit of tension in your fingers. You see that's the tension from nothing to a little bit of tension.
Okay.
Now with this, hold a basketball.
All right.
So kind of sort of tight, but not tight really. You have to have that basketball shape. Okay, so hands are parallel. And then when you think you have it, squeeze your palms closer by an inch and then let them back.
Oh, that's present.
Yes, yeah, so there's right away a little bit of resistance, it's right? Present.
Yeah, sure.
Now, if you speed it up, you may feel it even more. You're at advantage if you've ever played with magnets.
Yeah,
now, when you try to push
that.
Them together and you can't.
It's like a very slight, maybe like if your hands were in water and there's a little bit of resistance.
Yes, yes. Now, you can speed it up a little bit. You know, for some people, it works a little bit better. And as you do this, get closer and closer and closer. There will be some spots where you feel it more or less. Mm-hmm. Now come all the way to an inch distance and make your hands flat, fingers straight. And start slowly rolling them around like this. Now your arms should be kind of relaxed. The tension is only in your hands. And you'll feel the center of that rotation, mm-hmm. as if your hand was or hands were following a certain path.
I'm starting to feel more heat.
Mm-hmm. More heat, a little bit of tingling in your fingers. Or if you stop and just move your fingers a little bit, they will feel as if they needed lubrication, kind of squeaky. It's all part of that feeling. And here you'll feel the center of this rotation, kind of right in the middle. Mm-hmm. And actually, for those who could not feel any of this, about 5% of you, push the middle of the palm with your
thumb. Is that a body hack? Is that what that is?
It's a body hack, yeah.
Soccer hack?
So you actually put a little bit more feeling in the center of the palms, and you'll feel it easier. At one point, you just go, boom, it's there.
Yeah.
It's not a big deal. But the point is to learn to feel this, and then with the same feeling, you can go around the body and feel those differences.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And then there are little variations, you know, you can bring it up to your face and see if you can feel your face with your hands or your hands with your face.
Right.
Just as if you were washing your face, but without touching it.
Sure. Well, especially up on top.
Mm-hmm. Now, if you ever have a headache, all you have to do is you go around your head with the same tension, go around, pull it down, and then shake your hands
shake
off.
It out. See, I knew and that. Then I was do taught it again. That before. You know, uh-huh. There's a lot of people, Csongor, that are go through their awakening, and they have all this built up energy. They have all this, what's going on? My hands are tingling. I'm hearing things in my ear. There's like, you know,
mm-hmm,
what's
mm-hmm.
And I was taught by my mentor, and I taught everyone else, just shake it out, like, you know, get that energy flowing. So it used kind of like just giving me second confirmation. That's it. Look, I'm all tingly already.
You can compare this energy to Jello. You know, it's kind of sticky, and then throwing it off is like that.
So to build the, I don't know, what would you call it, the energy span, and then to extract the pain, the key is to get rid of it.
Yes. If it's too much, get rid of it. If it's too little, you have to add. So again, we are searching for a balance that the body needs. It's very simple.
It seems simple, but I'm sure it takes practice.
It does take practice, you know, and that's what I try to simplify for everybody else who's awakening now. They don't have to go through 30 years of research. They can literally learn it in a week if they're fast learners. Heck, you can learn it in a day, the basics, and become a healer right there.
So you're saying if you're 35, you've never ridden a motorcycle or bicycle, you can ride a bicycle today.
I had a girlfriend who learned it at 24, so I'm sure 36 is also there okay. Yes.
Now let me ask you, you before you had found your mentor, your teacher there, you basically were just doing experimenting. Is it
pretty much?
Is there any dangers to that? I mean, could you hurt somebody, or can you make things worse?
There is danger to it. You can give too much, or you can take off too much if you're not experienced. However, since your energy grows as you practice this and as you work, you don't start with nuclear power in you, right? I mean, you may have it, but you learn it slowly.
Yeah. Okay.
So there's a small, very small possibility to make such a mistake. By the time you get to that power where you built up, by then you already know what to do. So there are not huge dangers. You know, you can overdo it and cause a little pain, or give somebody too much energy and they would feel like on a double espresso or so. You know, climb the wall and so.
Well, I mean, I read your book, the biotherapy, bioenergy.
Mm-hmm.
And you told a story in there where you basically knocked some guy out.
Yeah, there were a few occasions when I was young and
so
cocky.
Was that like the triple quad El Latte Grande?
Something like that. Yeah. So.
Yeah, so the story. So you meet this random stranger. You happen to know that you both share, you know, origins, country. You get along.
You know, I was
gonna
heal
him,
driving,
and you like put a bolt of lightning into him.
I was driving on the main road here in Florida. This was a very long time ago. My uncle was still alive here, and he sent me to the store for some ingredient. He was making a Hungarian specialty, and on the way home, I passed his bicycle. The guy was packed to the max. And an H on the back for Hungary. I'm like, there's no way. I mean, it's in Florida.
What's the chances? You know?
So I pulled over and I stopped him. And yes, he's from Budapest. He's going around the world. He's been on, I don't know, for 2.5 years already. Went through Asia, Australia, all over. And now he's in Florida. So what, are you hungry? Yeah, well, come follow me. It was a couple of miles. He was happy, you know, Hungarians, good food and everything. And then he was complaining about his wrists hurting from the trip. He had good stories. It was all cool. So, hey, don't worry, I stopped that pain.
Now, how long have you been doing healing at this point?
About 2-3 years.
Okay.
It was very early on in the States. Right. But as I said, I was cocky. I could, you know, move people already, no big deal. And it was part. Many times it is part of the healing process, especially if you have a group of people and you start moving their friends that they know they're not, you know, part of a show or something, then everybody's thinking, wow, if he can do that, you know, he can probably heal me. So it's a psychological thing. I've done demonstrations where I move back 100 people at the same time from like 30 feet away. It's really cool. So by the way, you can learn how to do these things as well. Takes a little time, but it's all part of my
I've already been practicing.
Seminar. Very cool. And so, yes, you know, it creates a whole new awakening when you do something like that.
Okay.
It's a part of the whole blast of energy. So it's open to everybody now. That's the beauty of it.
So when you were working with this guy, where you were just on fire and he was open and it just happened.
Well, what happened? I said, okay, just stand here. I didn't count on him being tired physically, or, you know, I was just cocky, like, hey, let's fix your wrists. And I did just the early movements and like, watch this. And I was behind him. And my uncle was sitting in a chair in front of him, just watching the thing. And he described it like this. Well, I was watching this dude and all of a sudden I see his eyes just went up and he went like that. Straight down. And I was standing there like, holy crap, now what? And my uncle was just sitting there, you know, well, should I get a shovel or can you fix him, you know? And so I gave him such an energy blast out of my cockiness that, I mean, he got to himself no problem, a few seconds. We put him on the sofa. This was 7 at night. He slept till 8 o'clock in the morning, like 13 hours or so. And he got up and he was like, wow, I don't know what happened, but I feel great. And then 2 months later, he sent the card that his wrists were still okay.
Oh, that's awesome. Yeah, so there must have been multiple factors there, you know, him not being tired and you being
strong. A lot of things. But after a couple of times that it happened in real life, I had to learn to kind of hold back. I got here around the time when they had that lawsuit, you know, the lady poured hot coffee over herself at McDonald's or something. Mm-hmm. And like, gee, if she gets $5 million, what are they going to sue me if I start knocking people out?
Yeah, does the medical Western medical world is just now starting to recognize this, right?
They've known about it before. Healing. I mean, it's been around since the 60s. There was a healing touch, therapeutic touch. It was popular already in the 60s for nurses and stuff. But you know, there's no money in it as far as pharmaceuticals or so nobody's pushing it. Now it's you want that doctor to give the patients pills if you're a pharmaceutical company, and not stop their headache right there.
Yeah, you want them to manage it, not cure it.
Yes. Yeah. So it's sad, but that's how the world
so you figured right out you needed like a volume button.
Yes. And so, after that, everything was cool. I mean, I learned to teach it that way too. So all the issues I ran into at the time taught me how to teach others better.
Yeah, well, that's good stuff. All right. Well, I'm fascinated. And I'm telling you, I you know, after reading your book, well, I was kind of into it to begin with. I've always had a little bit of, ever since my awakening, I've had the ability to feel aware for the feeling there, especially in like a I don't know, spiritual stores or a gem store. I can feel the rocks. I can feel the energies from the rocks. Mm-hmm. And I don't talk about it much because, you know, people think.
Well, rocks and shapes and forms. I have a big chunk of that in my book, how they affect your energy. And I was lucky enough to be a part of a tour in Egypt many years ago. It wasn't the regular tourist trip. We went everywhere before or after the tourists. First morning, I was meditating between the paws of the Sphinx. Mm. So we had such experiences. We were the only ones in the King's Chamber in the Great Pyramid, for instance. It was freaking amazing. But the energies that you feel there that are, you know, not natural, they're man-made somehow, because it's the shapes, the forms of these places, of these temples, were so overwhelming. I mean, some statues you feel vibrating, like physically moving yet they're set in stone. So there are so many amazing things out there that we still need to study and understand a little bit better.
Well, there and everywhere else around the world. I mean, they're finding the one in Bolivia, they found a bigger pyramid than the
right pyramid. Right. And they're talking pyramid is in Bosnia as well, and many other places. So yeah. we're kind of, you know, even in Egypt, they told us like, oh, we're happy if we discover 10% of what's there. Mm-hmm. God knows what else.
Well, so, they have that. I wish there was a different way for Egypt to tell their story than through the Egyptologists that are running, you know, occupying the story right now. It's political and it's religious.
Again, it comes down to certain prophets and so on.
You know, but there's so much information out there that the civilization is losing because of all that.
Right.
Go back to that. And we just have to, you know.
Hopefully we'll get to it. And I'm trying to be part of this new movement, this new generation of people who are aware of things and aware of their bodies, energies all together. You know, I my biggest problem was how to teach more people. You know, that's how the books were born. Then everybody wanted live seminars, which was great. You know, Berlin, Bucharest, I've been all over like Copenhagen and you know, beautiful places to teach it, but it stopped because of you know, the world right now.
Yeah. Talk about that for a second. Talk about that transition from, I mean, because the way I understand it, if I'm understanding it right, you've always had to teach people as you've gone along.
Yes. You know? I started relatively early, but since 99, I have been teaching internationally, and I take on any invitation. You know, if they call me from Australia right now and there's somebody who wants to organize it, I'll go there. If it's, I love to travel. It was always part of me. And so it became a symbiotic relationship with my vacations. I'd go, for instance, a couple of years ago, I flew to Budapest. There's my other motorcycle at my cousin's garage. Mm-hmm. We hang around. Then I hop on the bike. I rode all the way to Bucharest through the Carpathian Mountains and the most beautiful parts of Romania. Then I was there. I taught for a week. Then from there, I rode to Serbia to see my mom. So there was a little bit of work, but mainly vacation around it. And so I'm willing to do those things when it really doesn't feel like work.
Yeah,
it's all pleasure. And with this, you know, I ran into the obstacle with the pandemic. I could not fulfill many of those locations. And then I realized, well, they're calling me even from India. You know, there's no way. I don't know how I'm going to do that. And boom, the videos are done. So anybody can see that from anywhere. You know, the book, I have to plug it.
There it is.
Of course, it explains everything beautifully.
That's a great read, by the way.
But thank you.
And it does.
I take it as my masterpiece.
Oh, there you go. Yeah, it's a really nice read, and it really explains things, even down to the techniques, which is very surprising. You know, I got to give it to you, my man, because a lot of people, with the possession of the information that you have, want to hold on to that a little bit more. They want to charge a lot more for that kind of thing. And I give you grace for getting it out there as cheaply and as much as you can. I mean, your seminars and your book, boy, you could just, it's all right there.
I'd love to give it out for free, all of it. But people look at it weirdly if it's free or cheap. So it has to be priced right where it's available to everyone, which it is. And yet to have some kind of a educational value and life value coming out of it. So yes, it's very cheap if you look at it that way.
It's a good book, $10. I got the audio version. The only suggestion I can make, if you could do me a favor in your next book, do the audio recording yourself. Because your energy flowing through those words, I'm trying to like picture you reading this, like after watching your videos, and like this guy reading it does not get what's going on.
He nailed it a couple of places really well. So I didn't listen to the whole thing. It was enough to write the book itself.
That's awesome. Maybe next time. Maybe next time.
Maybe next time. Yes. Yes.
Good stuff. Well, Csongor, we're going to go right into our third segment right here, which is most of our guests' favorite segment. I know everyone likes talking about themselves and what's going on, but this is called 20 Questions. I don't know if you've ever played 20 Questions before. Ever done that?
I assume not this version. So
yeah, it was like a dating game when I remember it last. But 20 Questions. We didn't really have much time prepared before your interview, but we had some people send us some questions to the social media. We post out all over there and on my message board and everything like that. So we do have a handful of questions to ask you. So if you're ready to go,
is there a time limit for each question?
Mm-mm. No, no time limit. No, there's
excellent.
It's all you, man. However you feel to answer, you feel answered. They're going to be, I haven't really looked, so they're going to be all over the place. So
okay.
You're gonna see them just as much as I do. Okay. This is simple enough for Facebook. What is your mantra? Do you have a go-to?
I'm good. You know, it's like if I would write something for myself, but in Hungarian, it sounds a little bit different. Mm-hmm. So, and pretty much those positive thinkings that I came up with, you know, don't piss against the wind, stay positive and so on. I don't really have a specific mantra. I wouldn't call it.
All right. Some people do. Some people got that.
You know, if you ask me how I am, you know, it's always great or, you know, the best or so. So it's kind of part of the whole picture, I guess.
Yeah, right. The overall view.
Yes.
Look at the bigger picture for sure. Okay.
But otherwise, you know, I have some good ones from Uncle Joe. You know, the older I get, the younger I used to be and such.
I but, like that one. The older I get, I'm going to write that down.
The older I get, the younger I used to be.
The younger I used to be.
Right, it's a bad mantra. Don't use it, though.
You know? Maybe make a meme out of that for you. Old Joe. Okay, if optional, what point in your current life would you like to restart?
That's very tough because you can always go back one more thing, like, oh, and if I just did this or this, I would have to go back to age 3 probably to make everything, you know, super perfect.
Age 3.
You know, not have ever a toothache or not be a, you know, skip a few hangovers or so, or learn another skill or something differently. But otherwise, no, I wouldn't go back. I think I'm here because of the things that happened to me. And if I did it differently, I wouldn't learn the same thing.
I like that. Yeah, that's true, right? I mean, your trials and tribulations build you and your character and a person.
You're always at one point where you can start something new. It's right now. Yeah. If you don't like it, do something else. Whatever I wish I started when I was 20, I would wish at 70 if I started at 50, you know, so might as well do it right now. Do it now or have no regrets. If you're 75 and you can't have a day without a glass of wine, go for it. Have a cigar with it. You know, at 75, you did well. You know, you got to this point.
Congratulations.
Yes. I mean, there are people who smoke 3 packs a day and they make it to 100. It happens. Some people have good genes or good thinking or good something.
You know, I read a book recently about centurions, and they say there's like a significant amount of similarities between people that reach 100 years old that have, you know, in their life. Fresh air, clean food, hard work during their life, right?
Mm-hmm.
Family tie, fun community,
yes.
And always some kind of like physical exercise on a regular
mm-hmm.
basis.
Mm-hmm.
He seems to be like synopsis with anyone that gets to that point. And I can
mm-hmm.
imagine we can add a few of them, you know, less stress, good sleep, you know, that kind of thing.
See, that's another information we have available. We know where the blue zones are, what they eat, what they do. You know, it's just Google it and we can live like that.
Right. You know, that's easy information now.
That's simple, right?
Okay. I got a question from a Facebook Messenger. Worst roommate you ever had?
I haven't really had bad roommates, but I've lived in some crazy places. I lost an apartment. I mean, I had to get out of an apartment. They sold it and quickly find something else. And very close to the school, two of my friends lived there. And I ended up living with them. There was a sofa in the kitchen, and that's where I slept. The bathroom was the length and the width of the bathtub plus the toilet. So but it was a minute from school, so we literally woke up and just sleepwalked there.
There you go. Yeah, when you're young, you don't need much.
But I get lucky with roommates in general. Everybody was great.
Well, you're lucky there. Yeah, for sure.
Yes.
Okay. Another one from the messenger. Most unexpected advice you've ever received? That's a good one.
Don't get married.
Ooh. Oh, sorry, Liza.
I think that was the most unexpected, probably. Most
unexpected, and it came from your mother-in-law.
Oh, no, it was other people, but turned out right.
Married. Okay. I got one here from my good friends over at Telegram. Favorite date destination?
Ooh. Just a date, not a trip.
Yeah, favorite date destination.
Maybe
one you've had in the past or one you specifically like.
I've had so many good ones. You know, the Adriatic Sea is amazing anywhere. Anywhere you stop. I mean, I'm talking motorcycle trips now, but I can go without it.
Is your date into motorcycling? That would be the...
It was given... the last many years.
Yeah, I don't think anyone would date you if they weren't into motorcycles.
Right. But the absolute best, you know, what I could call date, we were already together. We were down in Key West and rented a scooter. And don't do that, kids, but we went without helmets and it was hot. And we pulled over at the coconut salesman and he gave us two coconuts and we continued with that. It was the ultimate relaxation.
Nice.
And then a little Cuban coffee here, a little bit of something else there,
hand rolled cigars,
something like that, you know.
What is it about Key West? We did our 10-year anniversary down there.
It's just that party energy.
We did the same thing, we rented the scooter.
Yes. It's the, you can't go farther south of there, you're stuck, right? And it's a happy place, and might as well you blend in.
Yeah.
That's the Key West experience.
Key West is great. Hey, I give a shout out to my good friend Jim Vester down in Key West, who just went through a survival cancer. God bless you, man. All right, another one from Telegram. This is an easy one. Who's your celebrity crush?
I'd say like Jessica Alba or somewhere.
It's an easy
beauty, intelligence, everything is there. Less craziness, I think.
Okay, that's a work. No one's going to deny that. All right, back to Facebook here. Worst way someone butchered your name?
So it's pronounced Csongor. It's Hungarian. It's rare in Hungarian,
Csongor,
too. In Hungary, you say family name first,
right,
and then your name last, right? In Serbia, they mix it. I was the only one in the military who was called by his first name because they thought Daniel was my first name. Even though it's last, it's already a mix-up. So I was Private Csongor instead of Private Daniel.
But the CS got to throw off a lot.
The CS is like CNH in English.
Right.
Hungarian language has 40 letters in the alphabet.
40?
And 40 letters.
I didn't know that.
And like 5 billion combinations of words.
Okay.
English language is counted in millions. This is in billions.
Well,
it's
an
amazing
language. I
didn't know
you guys had 40 scripts. How did that get past me all these years? That's interesting.
And it's one of the hardest languages to learn, supposedly. But the Hungarian literature is boundless. It's incredible. Limitless in what you can put together. So yes, butchered. Chongor, Chongar, Csongor, Csongor.
Csongor.
I finished these videos and I worked on closed captioning, just checking how it works. At the beginning, hi, I am Csongor Daniel. I'm here to teach you, blah, blah, blah. Hi, I am better than y'all. I'm here to... That was the closed captioning. How did it get to that? You know, I don't know.
Well, hey, if you take your name and you put it in a Google for audio thing, you're going to get a weird. I imagine that's a... Yeah, well...
That was also a question that came up when I became a citizen. Because you have a choice, then you can change your name for free.
Oh, really? Oh, they give you that option?
Yes. And so, Csongor, Charlie, nah. It's not, you can't translate that name. It's not like Steven would be István or Stevan or something like that.
Yeah. No, it's a solid name. I love it.
And then, I thought, well, maybe Jack Daniel. Or something, or just Daniel, because at that time I just introduced myself as Daniel.
1991, yeah, you had Cher, you had Madonna.
Yes, just Daniel.
Just Daniel.
But then you get to all these forms, online forms, first name, last name. Well, I only have one. Then what do I do? Mm-hmm. Double it up, Daniel. So I just left it.
Chongor, solid. No, I like it. It's a great name. Catchy too. I think it's waiting. It's going to be Master Csongor Daniel.
Or something. Who knows?
Might be the title there. Okay. Let's get to, we already talked about this. One thing that we that you would remove from the world. You can explain.
Yeah, definitely greed.
Greed's a good one, man.
Uh-huh. I mean, it did philosophically, it helped humankind to a point because somebody was greedy and wanted to discover something. Or make coast-to-coast railroad or something. So there were great things that happened from it. Or I'm, greedy. I want to get to the moon. And we end up on the moon or something. Mm. So there are certain things that have to be part of human civilization. We talk a lot about letting go of the ego. Mm-hmm. The great, but the ego is what brought us to this level. We are my ego makes me want something more and learn to type on the computer instead of having a chisel and working that in a stone.
But if there wasn't greed, would we still got to the moon? Would we still taken that transcontinental?
Well, let's
happen for a different reason or a different timeline, but would have.
If we can separate ego and greed, then greed is definitely worse.
Mm, yeah. Okay.
So I'd go without it definitely.
Okay. That's a good one. What's your best pickup line?
I really don't have one. I never worked.
Hi, I'm Csongor.
Yeah, somebody suggested one which was really interesting. Hey, do you know Csongor? No. Hi, I am Csongor. No, I don't have one.
Okay. All right. This is interesting. Something childish that you enjoy to do.
I have a lot of childish genes.
Well, you have children, so.
Well, they're adults now. They're over 20 now. So, but we still do stuff, go to the beach, do things together, play dominoes or so. But I'll go on a bike ride. I'll go rollerblading. My daughter brought her longboard here. I was like, I haven't stepped on it for God knows how long, but it's still, I have that need, to just let it out a little bit, show off.
I wanted to ask you, what is the football?
The fit wall is a good question. You know, I should be talking about it more. It's my invention. It's with two T's if anybody's looking for it. Fit ball with the two T's.
F-I-T-T ball, yeah.
It's a tennis size ball attached to a parachute cord that has a little adjustable thingy on it. And you can hang it around your waist and kick it like a ball, like a hacky sack, but you never lose it because it's on a string. It started first for the elderly. I wanted to work on them to get them in shape. But then I realized that 15 minutes of it, and boy, I feel it the next day. Then the same thing you can attach to the wall and adjust the height. So you can kick it against the wall or away from the wall, or lift it up, hit it with your hips, or do it like a speedball. So it's basically a gym that fits in your pocket.
I like it.
Oh, check into it.
I saw really this cool picture. I'm assuming it's your daughter in Florence. And and everyone's just like, you know, going, this is like nothing's happening. It's like, here's this big, beautiful cathedral, right? And here's this kid just, I don't know.
I have some videos. I have a football website.
You invented that? Is that it? So we can buy that?
Yes. It's only $20. I mean, you can take it anywhere. It's really cool.
I was thinking that the eye-hand coordinate, or in a case, eye-foot coordination.
Yes.
Exercise.
It's very good for soccer players, tennis players, you know, everybody who needs that. But technically, anybody has to step away from that phone and just in their minds, and you just see the ball, and anybody can master it. That's the cool thing. You don't have to bend over to pick it up.
Yeah, that's the thing about hacky that really sucks.
And I wanted to start a movement, you know, where people tape their experiences in different locations around the world. So I have them some. I was kicking it on the Red Square in Moscow back like 10 years ago. In I don't know, Vienna, in New York, Budapest.
A nice little video put places together.
Yeah, I have a Yes. It's really cool.
As much as you travel in different places that you are, that would be cool.
Yes.
Yeah, for sure.
I kick it at the airport. People look at me strange, you know. But
I bet your security looks at you strange as
well. Well, one day it will catch on.
Yeah, maybe so. All right, here we go. This is a cool question from our Facebook fans. This one comes off of the Studio Rome page. Three tools that you could not do without your job, or you cannot do your job without?
I actually don't have any. So I can be toolless and do it fully.
All you need is someone to practice on.
Yes.
To work with.
And I can be anywhere and anytime. I could be, you know, sitting here in my underwear and work somebody in Australia. We don't need, you know, Zoom connection or to see each other physically. So it's that simple.
Now you talked about it in your book. When you do remotes, people don't always have to be mindful that it's happening. They can just go about the routine. They could just have it. You just hit them up whenever.
So, you know, some people like to feel it, feel the treatment and the whole process. I give them the exact time that I will work on them. And they can lie down a few minutes earlier, spend 20 minutes lying down, and you can literally feel the heat, the tension, tingling. It's a very interesting sensation. But it still works if you do something else. I get asked by women to work on their husbands who are non-believers or so. You know,
really?
The results are still there. They don't know that I'm working on them. I work on babies or animals, dogs, you know, they don't have that awareness. Mm-hmm. I don't tell them, hey, I'm going to work on you. Mm-hmm. I just work on them. That's all.
Yeah, well, it's the same energy. It's just different form, right? So working on someone's husband where they're, that's good stuff.
Many, many of those.
All right. Here's a simple one for you. Thanks to our people over Telegram. Which TV series is your favorite? You got a go-to? Which ones you like? Which one's your best one?
So for years, I didn't really watch anything, but I liked Breaking Bad. It was the whole writing and the negativity of it actually had some kind of a positive reaction. I think it was brilliant.
Did you see El Camino?
No.
You know, they did a movie.
Oh, yes.
Right?
Yes.
The breakaway from the thing. It was like the alternate.
Yes, I've seen that. Well, you know, with most of these series, it's or movies, that first one is, oh, it's so awesome that, you know, they, again, the profit comes in. We have to make another one and another one. So some of them lose it, but, and that series was getting a little bit brutal in the third season, but the beginning connected to the end and somehow made the whole thing, you know, as a unit, as a, like a good book.
Yeah, it was pretty good series. I passed it for the longest time. Someone's like, you gotta watch it. And I normally don't take people's recommendations because.
No, we binged it after it was, after the series were
we
done.
We did the same thing. We watched the first one. I was like, all right, it's Friday. We can finish this first series by the end of the day, by the end of Sunday, no problem. And that's how we got into it, yeah. Okay, Facebook question. If you can make up a new holiday, any holiday, Csongor Day.
I have one.
Okay.
I have a perfect idea.
Let's do it.
So the pandemic week. Not one day, but a whole week. The earth stops. Everybody stays the hell home. Nobody starts a machine. Nobody flies anywhere. I mean, it's impossible, but to have such a week.
Like a reset day.
We noticed the first 2 weeks of the total lockdown, when they didn't allow people even to go to the beach in Florida. Well, we did. Nobody was out there. And we set out and looked up in the sky, not one streak, not one airplane, no boats, there was nothing. And as scary as it was, like an apocalyptic feeling to it, everything was all of a sudden clean. You know, in Venice, they could see the water clearly. The fish came in, and
I saw that.
Yeah, what did it take, a week or two? That would be my holiday. I'd give it another name, not pandemic holiday, but something.
That, you know, that should be like what Earth Day should be.
Yes, exactly. But it should be Earth Week, really.
Earth Week, reset that. Yeah, because you're right. Because the sky's cleared up. A lot of the business were shut down. The roads were quiet. People, I mean, I live in a country, so I don't, but I've had friends that live in the city in urban areas, mm-hmm. and they said the lack of sounds was really hard to get comfortable with. I remember when I was a child, I lived in northern Indiana in the country, and I used to go the summers and stay with my grandparents in Chicago, and they lived downtown Chicago. And you know, three stories with a gangway between them and all that, and you know, for the first couple of days I couldn't get any sleep.
It's the
noise going
yeah.
by, and the sirens and the people next door and the garbage trucks in the alley, and this, you know, and after a while you just get used to it. And then I go back home for like a week, I couldn't sleep, it's too quiet. I had to turn the radio on, I had to leave a TV on or something like that, you know,
so. Yeah, I'm in the jungle too, I have no noise. Just
so the people that went through that, you know, that first week, like you're saying, that shutdown, they really mm-hmm. experienced like a culture shock.
Yes.
And I think some took advantage of it and some was like really, you know.
Well, imagine a huge Earth-sized collective stress. Mm. That's what happened and was going on.
Yeah.
So.
Maybe that's, yeah, maybe
get
that's
rid
a
of
reset.
It.
Reset. All right, here we go. Back to Telegram. These guys, I tell you. Name us one celebrity or famous person, dead or alive, that you would like to fight.
To fight? It would certainly be somebody who I could beat.
Yeah, you're a good guy. I mean, you can handle it.
I don't know. It should be somebody I don't like then, I guess. If it's just a celebrity fighting, you know, just messing around, Mike Tyson, of course.
You want Mike Tyson?
Yes, Mike absolutely. Tyson? Bruce Lee would be nice to hang with. definitely.
For a short period.
I met a few of these big guys. I have students in the UFC and the fighting world as well. Some of my students could barely walk through the door here, but they're so amazing. I have to mention Eric the Viking, Leander. He's a bare knuckle heavyweight, the sweetest guy. I mean, he's very much into the energy, and it helped him a lot to heal him. So, and many others. It's really cool.
I still wouldn't want
them. I could not. I mean, I was doing demonstrations in Tai Chi where people could not move me, or I would move them, and such. This guy, he was like a rock. Like I was pushing a wall or something. So I could certainly outrun him, I think. But as far as fighting, I have no chance.
Yeah, once you get to Zane.
It would be same with Tyson. You know, maybe I could be faster, but no.
Okay, here we go. That's good, yeah. Most outrageous customer you've ever had. It's from our Facebook friends.
Ooh, I mean, a few crazy ones that would be hard to mention. Definitely not by name, but you know, people who just get like into sexual mode or something unexpectedly.
Oh, you got the massage thing going on. What about your clients that you heal though? I'm sure you've had some really weird requests.
Ah, oh, gee. Off the top of my head, I mean, I get stuff every week, all the time. I mean, from the littlest things to the biggest, you know, healing cancer with one person and the other one has a trigger finger. A big difference between the sessions. I'm trying to, who is the most outrageous? I really can't think
okay,
of it.
Okay, I'm going to answer for you what would be mine if I was you. Someone
yes.
asked me to heal a barn of horses.
Yeah, I've done that. It wasn't that outrageous. It's actually the one of the happiest occasions. After the second or third horse that you work with, it doesn't have to be the same day, one by one. They know you're coming and they're almost looking like, pick me, work on me. It's such an amazing energy.
Yeah, horses are fantastic.
Horses are really cool. I mean, I worked on horses, dogs. Oh, I worked on a snake before. That was, I guess, a little bit off the usual.
Off the usual.
That
would be
yes.
the most, okay. All right, really easy. Give us your favorite quote.
Albert King, blues guy.
Mm-hmm.
He had a song. Everybody wants to go to heaven, but mm-hmm. nobody wants to die.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a great. I like Albert King.
I have many others. It just that one kind of stuck with me. Like very interesting human psyche. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Here's one from Facebook. Also, do you collect any items? Do you have a collections? Stamp collections.
I used to as a kid.
You collect anything now?
I have 5 motorcycles in the garage.
I guess that would be a collection. Right? More than you can use at one time would be a collection.
Well, you know, the real biker says the right number and the right amount of motorcycles is mathematically N plus one.
Well, you have to have one for each occasion, right? You need the road bike, the dirt bike.
No, I just overdid it. I think in general, people have too much possessions, and I try not to collect anything for that reason. I just, you know, they got piled up somehow and they're part of my energy and hobby. And so, but yeah, I don't think I need more than one or two.
So what are you going to do with the others?
Well, I'll sell them eventually or see if the girls get into it.
Maybe so.
A monument, maybe.
Yeah, yeah, right. Place one out there. Stay with Facebook. One thing people wouldn't guess about you is.
There would be many things, I guess. Um, I don't know. I can shoot.
You're a gun enthusiast? Shoot, or you can shoot basketball?
I was a target shooter my whole life. I was a champion for 16 years in a row.
Really?
In my region. So I can pick up any weapon and shoot it perfectly at a target, but I don't really know weapons that well.
You're just good
at I have a few. I mean, I was a club shooter, you know, always used the club's weapons. So I have a few guns and rifles to practice, but, you know, I'm not like a big shooting enthusiast per se or gun enthusiast, but I love the concentration that needs to be put in.
The breath
and
work.
And you close your entire mind and mm-hmm. you're just on that one target. And you have to concentrate on three points to get it right. And then you're breathing and everything. So it was, I mean, I've done sports. I was swimming. I was into karate and everything. But the shooting stayed with me as a gift, really.
Okay. All right. Well, I have a question myself. I saw you did a seminar for a small group for Betty McCormick sometime back.
Yes.
And she said something that you were, quote this, resetting her clock. Can you explain to me what that reference to?
So I actually reset everybody's clock at the end. Not with a punch or anything, but similar. During the treatment, the energy goes back to balance, it relaxes, and you relax, everybody relaxes through the treatment, even if it's a few minutes long. And at the end, we do a little hit on the back of the shoulders, like the upper
trap or something.
It doesn't have to be a specific spot, but just somewhere in the upper traps, like a little shock that we're looking for,
like a punctuation.
Yeah, just a little boom like that. And you go, ah! So what happens here, imagine when your energy is in disarray, you have these internal clocks and one it goes a little bit fast, the other one is slow. You know, it's not working together. And we give the body at the end, when it's totally relaxed, a little shock. And it stops all the clocks, you know, just boom for a split second. And then they all synchronize, they start working together. Kind of like rebooting your computer in that way.
That makes sense. Okay. Now that I explained that. Because you
and
you,
so
she
yes,
said and, that, but it was not a reference to it in the rest of the seminar. And I'm like, I gotta find
Yeah, it's almost out. Like well, it's in part of the book and the videos also. I explain it in more details and why we do it. But that's the simplest. It's every session is basically like restarting you, rebooting the computer and starting from scratch where you're in that perfect balance.
Yeah, that makes sense. Okay, cool. All right, let's get one more question in here. Let's see. Yeah, we talked about that already. Here you go. Last question. Best birthday ever.
Ooh,
got a few to choose from.
Yes, I had quite a few to choose from. Oh, gee. I had some amazing ones, you know, around the world. But really, quite frankly, to think back, last year in Key West, that was a good kind of pre-weekend thing. I mean, pre-birthday thing. But back in Yugoslavia, before I came to the States, we had a birthday where we just took all our stuff and went out into a vineyard overlooking the town. And we made paprikash in a big kettle and just set out as a big group of closest friends. So. Yeah, you know, the friends and family kind of win out over the best places on the planet.
That should be that way.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
It really should be that way. It don't, Don't need much, people. Don't need much to be happy.
I tell you.
I tell you. Well, I appreciate you playing the 20 questions game.
It was tough, but thank you. Yes.
Didn't do so bad. Normally, I tell you, normally we get like a couple of weeks to put the ads out there, and people start thinking hard about these questions. They go and see who you are, and they start asking about your, you know, your practice and, you know, philosophical questions. So I gotta say, so far you've gotten off pretty easy.
I was waiting for like, oh, which character from which Tarantino movie that struck your chord the best. But yes.
That's good. Well, we didn't make it too hard on you. That's okay. All right, so look, I want to talk about your book. I'm really interested about this children's book. How is that doing?
It's fine. It's that was also a project when the timing was right.
Girl with Healing Hands, is that right?
The Girl with the Healing Hands, yeah. It's based on my daughter. My oldest was 2 years old when, out of play, I was working on grandpa's knees. And he had painful knees, and I worked on one. And she came over as a two-year-old, walked over, looked at what I was doing, and she started doing the same, mimicking me. And it was cute. It was funny. Everybody was laughing until grandpa went like, "Whoa, wait a second. I can feel that." And the pain stopped. And so, I started playing with her more and more, teach her to feel the energy and see the energy. And later on with her sister, I would put them to sleep at night by looking at the energy between our hands and playing with it and that kind of stuff. So they grew up with this being normal to them.
Beautiful.
You know, if you have a headache, you know, they didn't know that there was a pill for that, you know, let's stop it, you know, or
sure
such. And so when Kylie was 9, I got the idea like, hey, why don't we just make a book? So, okay, I'll do it if you make the illustrations. And so I wrote the story and I made her at 9 to do the illustrations.
Oh, that's awesome.
And today she's a high school art teacher, by the way.
Oh, so, fantastic. Yeah. And now does she or any other children work with energy healing?
Occasionally. They but do it once in a while, not nothing like it. And in school, they realized at one point, like, oh, nobody else does that. It's just us. And so they kept it, you know, quiet. Sure. They didn't want to get in, you know, become weird or so. But last year of her, I believe it was elementary school, she was in the cheerleading squad and one of the girls fell off the top. And while they were waiting for the ambulance, she went there and stopped her pain. And then everybody like, oh, you can do that? How was that? You know, what the heck? And then all the questions, you know, come in.
Sure.
But, you know, this is another thing that anybody can learn in school, or they should teach these things, just like they should teach more art and history and science and stuff.
Do you think it's easier for young people to pick and learn this up?
Oh, yeah. We're all born with this. They just teach us how to feel things and see things and so differently. Mm-hmm. So slowly you lose these abilities of, you know, hearing things, seeing things as a kid. Now you're concentrating on the physical world.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But kids pick it up, no problem.
Yeah, it's probably, I was thinking it was going to be the same thing. The kids I work with meditation, man, they go right to it.
Yeah, that's why we came up with the children's book, and they learn how to feel and see the energy in the book, or see that, yeah, it's normal, and also learn how to stop headaches and pain. It's very simple, simply written, so 7 and up, they can understand easily.
Excellent.
Even youngers, if they, you know, read it to them.
Excellent. So what do you got working on now? Are you working on another book to help us and save us and teach us more? Yes, please.
I actually started the book. I'm halfway done, again, thanks to the pandemic. But it's not about energy healing. I figured I've written 3 about it already. This will be motorcycle trips, touring, intertwined with the life decisions and lessons and love. So it has a beginning and end, kind of connected with the technical stuff.
But that's gonna be fantastic.
Yes, it will be. It will be very entertaining and positive.
Well, we've learned from this, anytime that you combine your two passions or more than one passion together, it turns out to be something good. So this
it's just
great.
You can't go any better than that.
No, right? It's freaking amazing. All that you want in there in one book. That's fantastic. Well, where can we? Why don't you give some shout outs of where people can find you and what seminars you may have coming up, and where we can get you? And
well, the best is if you follow me. Actually, check my website, CsongorDaniel.com. I'm sure you'll have it somewhere written out.
Yeah, we'll put it down below for sure.
I'm present on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, all of that. So the online seminars are available anytime. You buy them, you can watch them for 6 months, as many times as you want. So it will definitely stay with you. The books are available on Amazon and also on my website. And if you are into traveling, you have that bug and you want to learn this at the coolest spot in the Austrian Alps, you have to come with me in July. We'll be there for a week. It will be an amazing opportunity. I've done these seminars around the world. They always take close to a week, and we start the day with meditation, Tai Chi. Then we do a little bit of studying. Then we enjoy the Alps. Then in the afternoon, more meditation, more studying, healing. You learn everything in a week. The spot is in Vart, Austria. It's about an hour west of Innsbruck. Absolutely gorgeous place. We rode there last year. I have a friend there who is a former Olympic skier. He built this kind of apartment hotel or so. It's €1,000 a night in season per room. Wow. The entire seminar with the room, with the food, with everything except for the trip will be $3,500.
Wow, that's so very
it's
reason.
Like 3 days staying there, but we're there for a week and with everything included.
Well, your friend must be very supportive of what you're doing.
He is. He is now an agent for many famous athletes, and so I've been working on his clients many times, and he's very happy to have me there. It's off season. Instead of being white, it's all green.
This sounds like gorgeous. An amazing retreat. How many people do you normally gather there?
All my seminars, I try to do between 10 and 20 only. So it's very personable. You learn a lot. I've done some big ones in Bucharest. I had like, I don't know, 40 people in the seminar, which was also fun, but this is cooler. So our goal is no more than 20 people for this one. We have the entire place for ourselves. We'll have catered amazing food every day. And all we have to do is relax and study and be positive.
That sounds fantastic.
I
wish I can join you. July is my busy season.
Oh, and I have to give a little advertisement to that. Whoever brings whoever or somebody signs up through them, I give them a $500 discount. It's a little motivation.
There you go.
You bring seven people, it's free for you. It's something that will give a motivation to those who can't afford it, you know, just like that. But it's still available.
And what about working with you personally, either learning or getting healing treatments? How does someone get a hold of you that way?
Same. It's through my website. I do long distance healing every day. I work on individuals, but also twice a week, Tuesdays and Fridays, I do a free long distance group seminar. A group healing session. So every Tuesday and Friday morning, 9 a.m. Eastern time, you kind of connect with me in your thoughts and then do your meditation. Everybody connects through me. Then you concentrate on your own issues. I have a Facebook page dedicated to that. You can read the rules, you know, how to tap
What's
into
the name
it.
Of the Facebook page?
It's a long distance bioenergy healing or a long distance bioenergy group healing.
Group healing?
We'll find it. The links are on my site as well.
We'll make sure the links are down in the bottom.
It's very cool, and the more people participate, the stronger the energy gets.
Well, you can expect to find me there every now and then. I'll
do excellent. Sure. Excellent. Excellent. Tomorrow morning, 9 a.m.
Yeah, you know what? I just might have to do
There you go.
I appreciate your time, Daniel. It's been a fun time hanging out with you and getting to know you, man. I do think your work is wonderful, and I think what you're doing. Thank you so much. I do appreciate it. Yeah, I appreciate your time. Thank you very much for stopping by the show. And we'll see you maybe around the internet, maybe even tomorrow morning.
Hey, great. Thank you for having me.